Send it on down. Let the
That was okay.
We are so glad that each and every one of you are here tonight to celebrate one of the most wonderful people that I know. My mentor, my friend, my colleague, Pastor Bob Laughlin. We're going to have a wonderful time tonight. There's going to be a lot of things happening. We've got a lot of videos that people have sent in, Bob, that want to express just how much you mean to them that couldn't be here tonight. Got a lot of music. And we've pulled out some, and I was a little selfish. I went through all the WEAG archive videos and pulled some that I thought were hilarious, and I hope you do as well. But you will. But we're going to have times tonight to not embarrass you, bud, but tell stories you probably have never told others. To what? Yeah, there's a reason, because we can't fire him now. But we're going to start tonight. You know, John, Pastor Hirschman's been bugging me for a long time that he has something he's been wanting to read to you for a long time. And I told him no. The first 10 times, and him being my neighbor, he just hassles me all the time. So, John, I'm going to let you do it. Where are you at? Yeah. Come read it. Oh, rock star. Bring the whole thing.
My hip weren't injured, I'd do it.
If you hear a high-pitched ringing, it's not the mic. It's probably the batteries are low in his hearing aid. So,
well, this smile is a fake smile right now, and I asked if I could do this early in the service because I didn't want to put a damper on the rest of the service, but I do have something to share that has irked me for many years. My sharing this morning was a tad bit disingenuous because this burden has weighed heavy on me. And until I've gotten rid of it, which I hope to do tonight, sorry, Bob, but it's got to be done. You and I are buddies, but some of that has been, you know? You didn't realize it. You don't realize anything. But anyhow, let me just set the stage, so to speak, for this. About 1987, when the master's plan was really rolling down at the Carpenter Center, Bob, in one of the early performances, asked me if I would be in the production. And I humbly said, I don't think so. I've never done a production. I can't do much, and I can't act for sure. And he said, I want you, he said, you have a decent voice. At least you can keep a tune. And I want you to be John the Beloved with another person who will play the role of James. And you just have to sing. It's a beautiful song that I wrote, he said, and I would just like you guys to sing it. And I just felt for him, and I said, okay, we'll do this thing. Well, what happened was I really did better than I thought I would, and certainly when anyone else did. And you know, what I discovered is that there's a network between theater critics, and they have newsletters and things that inform one another of what's happening in the United States in the theater scene. And somehow or another, a critic from New York, in the New York Times, one of the writers for the Times, it just caught his eye, and he said, well, yeah, I'm going to go up there to Virginia and just see what's going on up there in this musical, The Master's Plan. And so he apparently came here, and the next day there was a small article in the New York Times, which would have been a big article here. And there was an article as well in the Richmond Times-Dispatch that Bob, with great pleasure, read to the cast the next night to encourage them. But it was just a general overview. The Master's Plan hits Richmond at Christmas, at Easter again. And it was one of those one of those kind of innocuous reports that Bob wanted to read just for the cast to encourage him. And he did. And then I was waiting and waiting and waiting, and no, not a word. Well, I have saved, from all of these years back, this page from the New York Times Arts and Leisure section, okay? And I'm going to read what that critic wrote. And for purposes of not placing myself in a position of having a lawsuit or anything, I'm not going to give you the name of the critics, the author of this, what I consider is a very fair analysis of that production. So here we go. His article is entitled, Newbie Actor Spellbinds Easter Show Audience. The Easter Bunny came early yesterday afternoon for an ecstatic audience of 2,200 attending the matinee performance of The Master's Plan in the Carpenter Center, Richmond, Virginia. What they witnessed was perhaps the single most dazzling performance ever by an actor on a Richmond stage. Yeah, how about that? Though producer Robert Laughlin downplayed the actor's performance as, quote, beginner's luck. Actor John Hirschman's debut as Jesus's youngest disciple, John the Beloved, made the character literally come alive scene after scene in the popular Life of Christ musical, thanks to Hirschman's incredible stage presence and thespian excellence. And he can dance! In the dynamic and humorous disciple dancing scene, Nothing Ever Happens Here in Galilee, the audience was barely aware that there were 11 other disciples on the stage. Hirschman executed his box steps and high kicks with Fred Astaire perfection. In the wedding scene, again, it was Hirschman who played to the heart of the audience with his contagious smile, authentic Middle Eastern dance moves, and blood-curdling proclamation, "The wine ran out!" In Whatever He Says, Do It, it was Hirschman's near gymnastic freeze which riveted the eyes of the audience away from Mary and Jesus, apparently much to the disapproval of producer Bob Laughlin, whose slow head nodding and disingenuous approval was not effective in hiding the smirk on his round bearded Santa-esque face. Oh, I'm getting it out. As for my boys, my men would have been more appropriate, as Hirschman's biceps, clearly bulging beneath his loosely draped costume, astonished the audience. This could bring tears. It was his rendition of Lord, Make Me Like You that was the real showstopper, even with Shire's distractive role as James. So compelling and passionate was John the Beloved's performance that at times the words were rendered inaudible by the crowd's uncontrollable weeping throughout the song. Once again, adding to the chagrin of producer Laughlin, who had written the little ditty. At the end of the performance, instead of storming the aisles to head for the exits, the audience sat spellbound, their concentration broken only by occasional spontaneous and inspired outbursts of Lord, make me like you, which was on everybody's lips. If there was a weakness in Hirschman's performance, it was his rhythmic head gesturing, which the audience was more than willing to forgive when they realized that he was simultaneously directing the orchestra as Laughlin apparently had exited the auditorium for a bathroom break. Judge Jerry Lowe gets honorable mention for his effective role as a townsman, as does Earl Johnson as the priest, who is heard eerily whispering, "Something must be done." Pastor H.R. Roden's prayer at the end of the performance was also memorable, mainly due to the disrespectful group of Hirschman's fans who began chanting his name in the middle of the prayer. All in all, John Hirschman's amazing debut performance was one for the ages, certainly the most memorable in Carpenter Center history. As a theater critic who evaluates shows honestly and realistically, I am simply being truthful when I write that The Master's Plan was not a masterpiece. I would give it a B-, were it not for Hirschman's multiple contributions, which in my estimate elevate the show to a solid A. This was a one-man show with 150 stagehands. Thank you.
I'll get your mic for you, John. You sure that wasn't in Mad Magazine? Y'all are idiots. I love it. Oh, man. Hey, you like these T-shirts? I'm going to wear this loud and proud through Carytown, like, next week. But you have opportunity. Bob has always said this, that music is missions. So we've got a ton of these outside for you to go purchase if you would like to support missions. We're going to take the proceeds from these and we're going to present it to our missions department to help spread the gospel of Jesus Christ throughout the world, just like he has believed and preached for the whole time he's been here. So y'all going to go buy a T-shirt? All right, perfect. All right, well, Bob, we've got a video for you of someone who you hadn't seen in a while, but they love you bunches.
Hi, I'm Pastor Frank Messerano, founder and general overseer, retired now, of International Ministerial Fellowship, located in the greater Minneapolis area. And I'm so thankful today that you've invited me to participate in this celebratory gathering to celebrate not only Bob's 70th birthday, but his retirement now. And I'm so happy to be here to celebrate with you by video. I was asked to tell a couple of stories. Those of you who know Bob know that he's a very comical personality. He has great wit, and he can keep you laughing. And when he's a cohort on staff, we got into more trouble than, you know, we might have gone to jail for, but we didn't go to jail, but we didn't get fired either. But there were a couple of times that I wasn't sure if we were going to get out of there without me losing my job. I was asked to tell a couple of old stories, and one of them might have to do with the Jaguar incident at Mount Perrin. Dr. Walker had some excellent high-ranking officers of different corporations around the country who lived in Atlanta who were on his staff. One of them was Arvo Burrell, who was an executive with Gulf Oil. And Arvo was the treasurer of Mount Perrin Church for over 40 years, maybe even 50 years. And he was a wonderful guy, and he was sort of Dr. Walker's pet. And every time that Dr. Walker needed something that had to do with money or funds, all he had to do was mention it to Arvo, and somehow or another it got taken care of. So one day, Dr. Walker was talking with Arvo and said, I think I'd like to have a Jaguar. They're so sleek and fast. Dr. Walker was a speed guy. And so about a week and a half later, a brand new, spanking, beautiful Jaguar suddenly was parked in Dr. Walker's parking slot at the church. And Dr. Walker was very happy about it and was sharing with different ones. And not everyone, however, was happy about it. A couple of board members didn't like it. And they really shouldn't have objected because Arvo didn't use Mount Perrin money. He just mentioned it to one of the other very wealthy guys in the church, a guy, Bill Watkins, who owned Watkins Moving Storage Company. And the next thing you know, Bill said, hey, I'd like to do that. And so he wrote a check for $80,000, and the saints weren't happy. And so Dr. Walker said to Arvo one day, said, Arvo, it's not worth all this conversation. He said, just take it back and get me a Cadillac. So about 3 to 4 days later, the Jaguar's gone and a brand new, beautiful Cadillac is sitting in that parking slot. And Dr. Walker's happy and the church is happy in the kingdom of God. Except that during this time, I can guarantee you, Bob Laughlin didn't let this pass without a lot of really cryptic, funny, comical comments about how things work amongst the saints. And it apparently shapes up like this. If you're a pastor, I don't care how big your church is or how success it's enjoyed, Cadillacs, they're okay. But Jaguar, oh no, they're from the devil. And so Bob kept us laughing with all of his comments, and he was a joy to be around. Another story relates to him being something of a ventriloquist. Not only did he have a comical nature, but I found out early enough that while we were in the sanctuary on Sunday morning, sitting on the platform, as you know, some of the leading staff in the church, Bob and I had to sit certain services on certain Sundays of the month. Dr. Walker wanted his staff to be seen, and so we'd sit there behind Dr. Walker in front of 2,200 people. It seated 2,200 people, and the aisles were full. It was packed. And Dr. Walker, who was a phenomenal preacher and preached without notes and was anointed, and he was preaching that Sunday morning, and it was such an empathy service, and the Holy Spirit was there, and people were being moved on. And Dr. Walker got to telling this story about this very sad situation and how he had tried to help, and all of a sudden, Bob Laughlin, my good buddy, sitting next to me, leaned over, and in front of 2,200 people, whispered in my ear without moving his lips, "Oh, sure, Paul, I'm sure it happened just like you're saying." And I cracked up. So I had to resort to the old handkerchief situation, pull it out, put it over my face, and pretend that I was crying, and then wiping my eyes and saying under my breath to Bob, "Bob, when we get out of here, I'm going to kill you." And so we're pretty young guys in those days and full of a lot of sauce. But he was talented, not only Walker, but Bob Laughlin. Great, great minister, servant of the Lord, and a friend. And I'm just so happy I'm here today to be able to say to Bob and his beautiful family, and I love every one of them, to wish them and wish all of our friends at West End Assembly of God Church a very, very happy new year. God bless.
Son of God, yet son of man, and who laid down his life and rose to live again, who rides the clouds of glory, whose kingdom never ends. There is no other name, Jesus. Son of righteousness, worthy of the glory, Jesus Christ, the one and only. Let every voice in earth and heaven offer praise, and every heart become his holy hiding place. Let every knee bow down and every tongue confess the name of Jehovah's only Son.
separate you from the sweet Lord.
Daniel, Revelation, Timothy.
And the wisdom I discovered from cover to cover was enough to scare the devil out of me.
If you all recall, when we last looked in on Bible Bob, he was helping three children select a Father's Day gift. Let's see what he's dealing with today.
I'm not sure how I got the name Bible Bob. Well, I will say that as a young man, I would win our Bible baseball contests in children's church, and I could look up scripture faster than anyone, I don't mean to sound like I'm bragging, but you know, I was pretty doggone good.
That Bible Bob, he just knows everything.
Bible Bob's definitely the most knowledgeable pastor on staff.
Bible Bob? He's just so wise.
On na mom jeziku niko pojma nema što može biti Bible Bob.
If I have a question about the word, I always get a Bible Bob.
I didn't know how to study the Bible until I met Bible Bob.
I can't put up the front anymore. I just can't even learn the books of the Bible. I'm just a fraud. I feel like I'm living a lie. The only verse I can memorize is Jesus wept, and it makes me cry. And I can't do anything.
Oh, man. I tell you what, Bob was great at memorizing scripture, but not worship songs that we sing. He would make up words. Y'all didn't know this, but half the songs you learned through the years, he made those words up as he was going along. Let's stand together, because here's what we want to do. We figured what a wonderful time it would be if we went back through the years and what us music guys, one time Pastor Hirschman said, all we do is flip through a song Rolodex every week, and that's our job. But I know that us worship guys, we call the songs that they go to all the time, we call those sugar sticks that we know the people love. And we know that you'll join in with us to sing this morning. So we went back, we polled some people, and we found a few of those. And I asked, you know, Bob, he's brought Church of God, right? So was I. And so I've asked my Church of God folks to come out, because when we would come to church, we didn't rehearse. We just said, come on up here and we're going to play. Who knows where this is going to go? You knew you had a good service when the preacher didn't get to preach, or you had to put out more chairs. That's how we measured a good service when we were growing up. But are y'all ready to throw it back and see if you remember these songs? All right, well, let's do it. Well, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. All the righteous run into it, and they are saved. Oh, the name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run into it, and they are saved. Come on, sing it out. Blessed be the Lord.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Come on, Amiga, let's take it up.
Most High.
The name of the Lord is
a strong tower. Just run into it, and they are saved.
Oh, the name of the Lord is
a strong tower,
and the righteous run into it,
and they are saved.
Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High.
Is that one of your favorites, Bob? All right. Well, we're going to go on to number two that we know you love to sing and know that you love to lead through the years. How many know the love of God is the best love we can ever have? Amen. Kara, lead us.
The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. And it goes beyond the highest star and reaches to nor could the scribe.
my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the power throughout the universe display. Come on, every voice, just lift it to the heavens and sing.
And then sings my soul. I was going to put you on the spot. You know what song you sang 999 times out of a thousand? Well, you're going to lead us in that real quick. Just turn around and lead us in "Isn't He Wonderful?"
Well, isn't he
wonderful, wonderful, wonderful?
Oh, isn't Jesus
my Lord wonderful?
And eyes have seen, ears have heard what's recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Come on, sing it. Well, isn't he wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Oh, isn't Jesus
my Lord
so wonderful? Eyes have seen, ears have heard what's recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful?
You may be.
said, Bobo, look at it. And then you have to say, be wonderful. And we started singing.
Of the valley, let your sweet aroma fill my life. And rose of Sharon, show me how to grow in beauty in God's sight. Cherished of 10,000, make me a reflection in your life. Yeah. Oh, and they start shining. But then I see you standing near me, Lord. You're shining with compassion in your eyes. Oh, in your eyes. Jesus, shine down on me. Let your love shine through in the night. Oh, lead me, Lord, I'll follow. Anywhere.
I've read it in the pages of Matthew, Mark, and Proverbs, Daniel, Revelation, Timothy.
And the wisdom I discovered from cover to cover was enough to scare the devil out of me. The
words all have... Last week we watched as Bible Bob came face to face with reality. This week, let's pick up Bible Bob as he begins a new journey.
You know, Emmy, it's really been a lot of pressure being Bible Bob and trying to act like I knew more than I really knew about the Bible. And I'm just so clean and everything after coming out last week and letting everybody know I didn't know as much as I really said I knew.
Well, it's never too late to get into the Word.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking.
He said he needs
pages of Matthew, Mark, and Proverbs, Daniel, Revelation, Timothy.
And the wisdom I discovered from cover to cover was enough to scare the devil out of me.
The words all have...
Great change in me. I am
marvelous life, and it's all a great change in me. And I'll never be the same. No, I'll never be the same. No, I'll never be the same no more. Since my life has changed, I am not the same, and I'll never be the same again.
Danny Murray here at Lee University. Oh, I'm so happy we're honoring my buddy Bob Laughlin today there at West End. We've been friends for a long time. Matter of fact, 1971 is when I came as a freshman here to Lee University, and Bob was already here. Bob was a year ahead of me. 50 years ago we met, and man, we became buddies then and have been ever since. Let me kind of tell you about how it started here, when our friendship really developed. Now, we were all in the Lee Singers, you know, the big college choir directed by Delton Alford, and it was a lot of fun. And then out from that came the Singers 3. Let me show you right here. The Singers 3, a little prop for us here. We made this in 1973. Bob and Lynn Hancock and myself. Let's zoom in here and look at that. Yeah, look at those. Yeah, that's me right there. In that crushed velvet suit. That's right. People often wonder what happened. Well, I was going to a snake handling church back then. One of them bit me, and the swelling's never gone down, as you can see. But nevertheless, handsome guy that Bob Laughlin was. He was a big man on campus. I'm telling you. And we had the best time. We became a brotherhood. We really did. Then Paul Kahn, who recently left our presidency here after 34 years, he transformed this place, but he was a rookie faculty member back then. And he went to the board of directors and he said, listen, these boys, they've got a little talent, but they're all going to end up in jail. So why don't you let me take them for the summer and take them out on the road, and we'll go to youth camps. And they agreed, and here we go. We went out. We went all over the country touring together, and that's where the bond really came. We had the best time. Oh, if we could tell you some of the stories, which we cannot, but nevertheless. We did that, and then we sang together there for a couple more years, and then as it comes, we start graduating and leaving, and Bob went down to Mount Perrin in Atlanta, and Lynn went off to Phoenix, and I just stayed here, but our friendship has remained the same. Then we start having kids, and one of the greatest pleasures for me has been that our kids love each other. Yeah, you know, well, Debbie and I have four kids, and Bob and Karen had two. Jeff, let's see. I haven't kept up with Jeff a lot. I think I heard he went off to the Army or something. I don't know. But I do know he married that preacher's daughter up there at West End. Joe Hirschman. Yeah. Oh boy, he was a trip. John Hirschman, that's it, yeah. What? Oh, he's a doctor? He didn't go to the Army? I'm sorry, Jeff. I didn't know you were a doctor. Man, I wish I did. I've been getting some prescriptions or something. Anyway. And then Kara, Wild Woman Kara, and our Wild Woman Lauren, they talk every week since then. I mean, it's just been wonderful that our families have stayed together, but we love Bob. And I'm telling you, he's been a great inspiration to me. You know, Bob, from the time I first met him, I admired his his desire for excellence, and he was not going to follow the path of anybody else. His creativity was going to force it that he was going to have to, his work was going to have to be marked with something different. I know when he was at Mount Paran, I mean, years and years ago, before they had, you know, the youth groups ever had anything, he turned his youth group into Airborne, and it was a super creative thing. That's where he started Milan Lefevre and that group out of there, and all the great things. And then he came to West End, and the things he's done at West End. Bob, your creativity, it's amazing. I remember one time coming there, one of those musicals, and they turned the sanctuary. They said they were going to do it underwater. The theme was under the sea, and the whole sanctuary went under the water. I'm telling you, that guy's creative, and you all know that about him. And so thanks for all you folks there at WEAG that have worked with him and helped him to spawn all that creativity and do great things. You know, buddy, you set out to do it, and you did it. You brought Broadway to Richmond. And I'm telling you, we're proud of you. I love you so much. Now, we lost our buddy Lynn last year to cancer. And before he left, we had a chance to go to the studio and sing together on his record. So if you'd humor me for a moment, I would like to put up a picture of us singing back then, and then play a little bit of Bob singing and Lynn singing and us singing together. Buddy, I want you to know your friendship is a prized possession to me.
Oh, I've been a lot of places, and I've seen so many faces. There have been times when I felt so all alone. Oh, but in that lonely hour, yes, those precious, precious lonely hours, Jesus let me know that I was his own. Oh, and that's why I'm singing.
Through it all, through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God.
For every valley, I thank him for the storms he's brought me through. For if I never had a problem, how would I know my God could solve them? I'd never know what faith in his word can do. Oh, I can look back and say, through it all.
Hey, Debbie, come and say a word to Bob. Thanks for correcting me.
Sure, that's my job. Bob, I want to say I appreciate your consistency through the years and through the decades. Consistency in your relationship with us, consistency in your ministry and your work. I admire you very much. You have been and always will be part of our family.
Hey, congratulations.
We love you, Bob.
He said, He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. The Lord which keepeth thee, he will not slumber nor sleep. 'Cause the Lord is thy keeper, the Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand, upon thy right hand. No, the sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. Yes, he shall preserve thy soul even forevermore.
Yes, all of my hands. Hello, my name's Paul Kahn. I'm chancellor at Lee University down in Cleveland, Tennessee. And that's Bob Laughlin's alma mater. So whereas you know him as this very successful spiritual leader, musical leader, I accept all that. I've heard about that adult, mature version of Bob Laughlin, but I got to tell you, I remember the Bob Laughlin of college days because I knew him back in the day. So they told me to go ahead and talk about that Bob Laughlin. It was in the early 1970s. Bob was a student at Lee, and I was a young faculty member at Lee. And what happened was they decided to try to recruit students by asking me as a faculty member to go on the road with this trio. And the trio would sing and then I would speak. You know, we would go to youth camps and local churches. And we'd try to recruit students to come to what was then Lee College. So that trio was a group called the Singers Three. And so I traveled with the Singers Three all across the eastern part of the United States for two summers, and it was a hoot. The Singers Three was your friend Bob Laughlin, and then this really, really smooth voice guy, lead singer named Lynn Hancock, and then this sort of effervescent, spontaneous personality named Danny Murray. So these three guys were a wonderful trio. Actually, I hate to admit it, they made an album while they were undergraduates. Can you imagine the audacity of that? They made an album, you know, the Singers Three. I wrote the backliner notes, actually, and we enjoyed traveling around. Now, you got to remember, I was a faculty member, but I was only about like 26 years old myself, and so I was barely, if even at all, more mature than these guys. I remember we had young kids, and Bob Laughlin may be the only one watching this who will even relate to this, but you know what my kids call the Singers Three? The egg-sucking dogs to this day. They'll say, whatever happened to those egg-sucking dogs? And the reason they were called that is because I was a big Johnny Cash fan, and we had a Johnny Cash cassette that we played in the station wagon all the time, and it had this old song, "You Dirty Old Egg-Sucking Dog." And so these boys love this song. We played it over and over. We sang it as we traveled down the road. And my kids came to know this trio as the egg-sucking dogs. I hope that's not offensive. And if it is, I hope they edited it out of the video already. So we had some wonderful times on the road. These guys loved to sing and they loved to play sports. Laughlin, as you may know, is a kind of a wannabe has-been athlete. That is to say, he's a has-been wannabe athlete. Not actually an athlete, and probably never was actually an athlete, but he loved to compete athletically. Literally, I'm not making this up, we would do a service at night, they would sing, I would speak, we'd load up in a station wagon pulling a little van that had the equipment in it. We'd go down the road and find a bowling alley, and we'd go bowling for a couple of hours, then load back up in the van at about 11 or 12 o'clock and drive all night to our next appointment. There was no game these guys didn't enjoy playing, no way they didn't love to compete. They had these records made because the Singers Three were pretty good, but they really had they really felt good about themselves, and so they had this album made. Retro 70s outfits on the cover, really some pretty good songs on the inside. I remember we would sell those albums, and they sold very well because these guys were really stars. And we sold out of albums one time and had a case of them shipped to us. It was supposed to be delivered to some service station along the road. We got to the service station after it closed late one night, and these guys, you know, they said, "Don't worry, Dr. Kahn, you just stay in the car. Don't ask us what we're doing." They went around to the back of the service station, broke in to retrieve their records. Nobody got caught, nobody got arrested. No damage was done to the building, I hope, or to these young men's lives, or they might still be in jail. They were always playing pranks. I remember one time we were doing a student a banquet for a bunch of high school students, and I was trying to make some kind of point, and I turned to the guys and said, "Give me a drum roll." And Laughlin grabs a drumstick, sticks it through a bread roll off a table, and hands me the drum roll. I know, nobody laughed. Like, nobody's laughing now because they didn't get it, because it was such weird sort of type of humor. But after we got back in the car and headed away, we laughed about it all night long. I particularly remember the way Laughlin dressed in those days, because you talk about retro, like think early Beatles without a fashion advisor. So Laughlin was kind of a nice looking guy, you know, and all the girls really thought he was a handsome guy. I never got that. Actually, I thought he was somewhere between, you know, average and not so attractive, but the girls liked him, and so he dressed to please the girls. So he would wear these long pants that were way down over his tops of his shoes with big pleats at the bottom. And of course, the big platform shoes, the high heels, the platform shoes. It really looked pretty strange, but it was fashionable at the time. Never forget once when we started to pull out, Laughlin was late, we pulled away, he starts to run after us. There's some girls watching, he looks so cool. And his big old fat, flat heel got caught in his big old oversized cuffs on his pants, and he went sprawling on all fours on the ground, and all the girls oohed and awed and wondered if he was hurt, and we just broke up in the car till we finally got his raggedy old self in the car and ran on down the road. Hey, we had a good time. They were just boys, and I was barely older. But I've known and loved Bob Laughlin ever since. After he graduated Lee, of course, he went to Atlanta and actually worked in the church where I had worked before him and followed him there. And now that he came up to Richmond, he never has lost his sense of humor. He never has lost his sense of style. He's just got old, that's it. He's just got really old. I mean, really old. I mean, really, really old. God bless you, Bob Laughlin. We all get old, even you.
His home and went his lone and solitary way, and he gave to me a gift I know I never can repay. A quiet man of music, he denied a simple faith. Almost was a soldier once, but his music wouldn't wait. He earned his love through faithfulness, a thundering velvet hand. His gentle means of sculpting souls took me years to understand. The leader of the band is tired, and his eyes are growing old, but his blood runs through my instrument, and his song is in my soul. My life
life has been a poor attempt to imitate the man. I'm just a living legacy to the leader of the band. The siblings' lives were different, for they heard another call to stay up in Michigan and the other Orlando. You made your home in Richmond, where your dreams began to sail. Living out this life you chose, we've come to know so well. Leader of the band is tired, his eyes are growing old, but his blood runs through my instrument, and his song is in my soul. My life has been a poor attempt to imitate the man. I'm just a living legacy to the leader of the band. Time to grow. Thank you for your kindness and the times when you got tough. And Bobo, I don't think we said I love you near enough. The leader of the band is tired, his eyes are growing old, but his blood runs through my instrument, and his song is in my soul. My life has been a poor attempt to imitate the man. I'm just a living legacy to the leader of the band. We are a living legacy to the leader.
Bob, there's a rumor going around that you're thinking about retiring, and I just wanted to know if it's really true. To me, it seems like you're too young.
Too young, that's right. Yeah. I am so proud of you, Bob. I wish your mother was here to share this with you, but I am so glad that we get to. And we congratulate you and want to tell you how we've admired and loved you down through the years for the ministry. I was thinking back about your mom, how that she'd be so concerned when you were just in high school. We prayed many a prayer that God would put you in the right ministry. She said, I don't want him singing for just any old quartet. I'm wanting him in ministry. So we are so happy and proud of the years that you've had. And God bless you. You've got some good years ahead.
It didn't seem long to me when I was at Lansing and you was in high school and playing ball big time. Boy, did we ever enjoy that, Bob. But it seems like a lot of time has gone past both of us. I'm now standing in the 80 margin. And but you got a long way to go. Anyway, Bob, I think of all the good times we've had, you coming through Port Huron, you singing with the Singers 3, and you sang for us in Port Huron. You had the Atlanta choir with you when you went over into Canada, and you guys came by and sang for us. It seems like just a little while ago that that was going on, and now you've reached a point where you're going to retire.
We've got a lot of happy memories. A
lot of memories.
And I want to just share with you that one of the greatest privileges of our lives, we were so young, our son was only 1 year old when we met your family, but one of the greatest privileges
of our life is
being able to have been called your pastor. God bless you, and we love you.
Love you much, and God be with you as you go into the next part of your life. Love you much.
Love you, Bob. We love you. Thank you for giving us an opportunity to point people to Christ, the Son of the living God.
I live, because Jesus is risen. I live with power over sin.
I live because He is risen. I live to worship Him.
that's the last song of the night. No, I'm kidding. What do you think we're going to end with? Yeah? Y'all got to go line up outside in the parking lot. You're going to march in and let them watch you do it. But what a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful representation, Bob, from all of these people. 170-some people on this stage tonight who your life and your ministry has impacted through the years. And Bob always said it's about you. He always said that. And one thing he taught me, it's all about the people. It's all about the people. So we're gonna do that. We're going to end with Midnight Cry tonight. So sit back, relax, and enjoy.
And I hear the sound. It's of a mighty rushing wind. And it's closer now than it's ever been. I can almost hear the trumpet. As Gabriel sounds the call, he sounds the call, and at the midnight cry, we'll be going home.
I'm just kidding. Bob, I told you I was going to put you on the spot tonight. So come up here, bud. So for 11 years plus, this guy's given me directions. And that will give you directions tonight, okay? All right? So what's going to happen here is you're going to sing the next verse and chorus. Okay? Once you get through that, just like we used to do. So you're going to sing what you sing. You know the words. I look around me. Yeah, that. Then once we get outside of the first chorus, like sing through the chorus, and then I'm going to put you on the spot again. Don't worry, I'm not going to make you sing this whole song tonight. You're going to turn around and you're going to direct these guys in Midnight Cry. After the first chorus, okay?
I look around me. I see prophecies being fulfilled everywhere. You know the signs of the time. They're appearing everywhere. I can almost hear the Father say, son, go get your children. Oh, I could just go on home tonight, I'm telling you. Oh, and after midnight cry, we'll be going home. You see, when Jesus steps out, on the cloud to call his children,
to call his children,
all the dead in Christ, they'll rise to be the
I look around me, I see prophecies fulfilled every day. The signs of the time, they're appearing everywhere.
Can we just one more time give it all we've got for Pastor Bob Laughlin? Before we go tonight, I would just like to give Bob an opportunity just to say a few words. One thing I know is he's not long-winded. So be seated, and I'm going to have Bob just share from his heart for a moment.
Thank you. I'm not sure why I get to be this fortunate. I was sitting there and just looking at each face, every single one of you, every single one of you. You're my trophy, each one of you. And that's a refined, golden, shiny trophy in my life. Because it's been refined through the fire of our ministry together. Every one of you represent my finest hour. And I can't imagine someone as fortunate as me being able to have a ministry for this long and have their greatest dreams realized through the people that he loves. My desire was that you'd be proud of me because I wanted to serve you well. My desire was that we would serve them well. Our church, the body of Christ, the family of God, the bride of Christ that needs to be nurtured and loved and cared for. That was taught to me by my mom and dad and Brother Scott up there in little North Lansing Church of God. We probably didn't run over 75 people on Easter Sunday. But they taught me how to love God and love his people and to have an encounter with the love of God that's so much greater than tongue can tell. And it really does go beyond the highest stars and all the deepest depths. I will not blubber on here. It would be so easy. But I'm a churchman, as was mentioned this morning. My desire was to do nothing more than to feed the sheep, as Jesus told Peter at that breakfast in Galilee. If you love me, feed my sheep. And the family of God is the most important group in all of the world. And our church, the body of Christ, the family of God, is to be cherished and to go forward and to accomplish his purpose in the world. I'm so thankful for my best friends being able to be my partners in crime on staff, and to have Bob Roden and John Hirschman and Shane Schlesman as my pastors, and all of my colleagues. And I look over here and see Brian, who came in from, which is that Shane or Brian? You guys look alike. Pound for pound, still the most talented guy I've ever known, Brian King, right over there. Yeah. Again, I'm not sure why God would bless me this much to have my family here with me and all the gifted, talented, loving people. And I can't say thank you enough to be given the honor. Mom and Dad, I hope I made you proud. And I hope I made you proud. You sure made me proud.
Love you, boy.
Amen. Hey, the party isn't over. We're gonna go down to the gym, which is down this hallway. The far, we have a reception set up for people to come mingle, talk, just visit with one another. Bob will be there, but knowing Bob, he'll disappear into thin air at some point, if you know him. But what a wonderful evening, and not only these people here, but you being here has made it a wonderful evening. So we hope you'll come down. Don't forget, go get a t-shirt. It'll support missions around the world if you'll go out and get one of those. We are so glad that you came tonight, and we will see you down at the reception soon. Have a good night, everyone.